Welcome to another episode of Double Tap. Today we are joined by Koji, co-founder of Parallel Studios. Koji, how are you, sir?
I'm good. I think maybe a little tired, but I'm not sure if that's the game or the kid or just life in general. But I'm happy to be here.
Obviously, you guys are building Parallel, one of the more, I guess, renowned TCGs in the space, and having your second title, Parallel Colonies, coming out shortly, which is a sort of AI driven sim. So yeah, lots to discuss, but before that, disclaimers out the way. So the content here is for educational and entertainment purposes only. It is not financial advice. The opinions shared by Alex and I are our own, and we may have investments in some of the projects or assets discussed throughout the show. With that out of the way, Koji, what games are you playing at the moment?
What games am I playing at the moment? Well, other than a healthy dose of Parallel, because we just released our expansion, and I don't mean that as a plug, but only because I'm excited to see how players are reacting. I'm jumping in there and going crazy. But outside of that, the next biggest game on my list is probably Balatro. I'm now frustratingly trying to get through all of the challenges, which is far more annoying than just winning with the decks. But that type of game is right up my alley. And then I'm eagerly anticipating the new Prince of Persia roguelike that's coming out, and playing the last one that just came out not that long ago. So yeah, not many Web3 games, unfortunately, if that's the answer that I was supposed to give.
No, definitely not.
Yeah. All right, so kicking it off, you know, last time we chatted briefly, one of the main things we talked about was like kind of starting with the core loop of a game and then layering blockchain on top of that. So kind of just initially, you know, Parallel does a great job of layering blockchain on top of a known genre, TCGs. So we were curious, like, what are some of the ex post effects of game design and monetization as you kind of layer on the Web3 elements to something that gamers are a little bit more familiar with?
I mean, that's a good question. It's tough, right? To give like an interesting or robust answer, because one of the reasons we chose TCG is the sort of the things that you would normally associate with Web3 already baked in, right? Like the audience, you know, outside of the digital TCG players, but like the audience who's used to things like Magic the Gathering or Hearthstone. In fact, today I was trying to hunt down some alpha, beta, or unlimited cards for a collector friend of mine, right? And that just kind of goes to show you that the markets are very much part of the game, and the collecting is very much part of the game, especially when it comes to Magic. I mean, obviously no one's buying Black Lotuses to play them anymore, but even probably some people who are outside of Magic the Gathering know what a Black Lotus is, right? And so the idea of buying, selling, and trading makes sense to your average gamer. And so that element of Web3 is sort of already baked into the audience. The one thing that does make things slightly more challenging is the tokenomic side of it. Now, obviously, you know, designing in-game economies is difficult. And then when you take an element of that in-game economy and then move it out of the econ, or sorry, out of the game, but it still needs to remain in the econ, then you get it some difficult, I guess, sort of game design. It's more economic design, but it obviously does flow into the game part of it. And so, you know, we've played it pretty safe, right? We've moved while you can earn Prime playing Parallel, the actual redemption of Prime for in-game assets, you just turn it into the in-game currency the same way that you would, you know, your credit card or other dollars, other fiat currency. And so at the end of the day, when we're funneling it back in, we treat it like we would any other currency. And even when you're acquiring assets in our drops or whatever using Prime, again, it's just treated somewhat like currency. So we're kind of playing it a little bit safe there. And I think it's kind of important because we don't, you know, we're trying not to let the Web3 affect the game design too much, because I think that if you over, I don't know, not over incentivize, but if you make it too economically driven or too complicated, then you're going to lose audience. And I don't think there's enough people in Web3 as it stands to sustain a game. You need to attract your average gamer, your Web2 audience, whatever. You need to hit critical mass. And so you have to keep it as simple as possible and make it feel as familiar as possible, which is another reason why sort of the Web3 part of our game is opt in as much as you want. I like to joke it's like Fight Club, you know, or Project Mayhem, I guess, in Fight Club. Like your level of involvement is determined by you.
It sounds like internally you guys kind of go back and forth in terms of like, hey, how do we reveal the Web3 elements, right? How do they unfold? Or how, like at what point within kind of the loop do we kind of reveal the Web3 elements and then enable the users or the gamers to opt into that? I'm curious, as you kind of layer additional complexities to that in-game economy that are tied to the Web3 elements, like what's the internal discussion like? Like you mentioned that, like, you know, you need a strong cohort and a strong foundation of just gamers. And then some of those people will interact with the Web3 elements. But from like a game design or an economy design angle, I'm curious, you know, beneath the hood, how do you guys kind of decide, hey, this is something that's too financialized, you know, let's kind of dial it back a little bit, and then, you know, vice versa?
It's a great question. There's a couple ways to look at it. I mean, the first one, from a very general perspective, basically we discuss it like we're, you know, the metaphor of boiling a frog, right? Like if you throw a frog in hot water, it's going to jump right up. But if you slowly turn up the heat, you know, the saying goes that the frog will boil itself or whatever. I've never actually tried it, but the idea here is that like you get the gamers in and you slowly expose them to the Web3 element. You know, as an example, our battle pass card, if you buy the battle pass at the end of the season, you have the option to mint a special card that you can only get in the battle pass, you earn the special card that you can only get in the battle pass. And it's an apparition version of that card, which is a non-Web3 version. But you have the option for no additional cost other than the gas to mint that card. And one of the theories that's been sort of being proven out in real time right now is that, you know, someone will opt to not mint that card at the end of the battle pass and then see it later on the market and be like, shit, why didn't I do that? Like, I know I don't really understand this Web3 thing, but like, I should give that a try. To get like a little bit deeper and answer your question a little bit more, I think that the internal discussions really are about what products we're putting into the game and who are they for, right? Because I think there's like a Venn diagram thing going on. We have like in one circle, the Web3 users, and another circle, we have the pure gamers. And like in the middle, there's like a section of people that overlap. But I also would argue that in a third circle, we have like your traditional collectors. And so I think we look at their products and say, okay, is this like a more Web3 focused element? Is this a more collector focused element? Is this a more gamer focused element? Are there overlaps in the Venn diagram? And depending on who it's for, we can dial up and down the level of complexity, because we do have some out of game elements that are sort of more Web3 chase items, things that will yield you more prime while playing the game, that sort of thing, that's obviously of more interest to the Web3 play to earn side of things. And so we allow it to be a little bit more Web3 complicated.
I really like the example you used of a Web2 user who might convert later to a Web3 user through the battle pass. I'm curious, are there other things that you guys are tracking at like the wallet level within the context of, you know, collecting or just playing the game, that you guys are using as like feedback loops to kind of better understand those three different like circles in the Venn diagram?
It's interesting to see when you have a wallet that owns a ton of cards, but those cards, that wallet never gets attached to a parallel account. You're thinking to yourself, okay, so like, or parallel assets in general, like what are they doing? Because they're not, you know, they're not playing the game with those cards. Probably the hardest part is analyzing gamer behavior. Although we have like a history of you know, years and years as human beings of a game creation and digital game creation and trying to track their behavior, it's not as laid out as, you know, you look at the blockchain, you look at the ledger, you can see what people are doing. It's much easier to follow.
So the game has been out in beta for a couple months now, and I'm curious to get some insights from you on the early feedback. So to quickly take a step back for a second, classical TCG players are typically like fairly hardcore gamers, and hardcore gamers typically have a ton of like negative connotations around NFTs and tokens and blockchain in general, like mostly for good reason. However, at the same time, Parallel has seen some relatively pretty impressive organic growth and tractions among like TCG KOLs and like esports competitors and stuff. So I'm wondering, like, how are you currently weighing the feedback from like NFT haters with the organic growth? And I'm curious whether or not NFT ownership or potentially like the rewarded incentives had any impact on that growth.
Yeah. I mean, again, another interesting question. I'll start with the first bit of it, which is obviously the initial piece of our audience is coming from the Web3 side of things, because the way this whole project started, it was pretty much crowdfunded through Web3. So, you know, that there's no denying that. And they've been our like sort of truest believers and loyalist patrons. But what I found interesting about even that side of it was we have had a lot of people tell us that our game has been their first NFT that they've ever purchased. So we've also, even before the game was out, seemed to onboard some players. I think the promise of a digital TCG with ownership that was sort of sci-fi based has a lure for a certain group of people. So that worked out definitely in our favor. And then on top of that, you know, you mentioned the KOLs. By the way, I hate that term, but I guess it's just what we're using now. But yeah, Alistraza, who is, I will forever be grateful for her. And she is now one of my good friends, her and her husband both. They found our game, you know, just in the ether. They're like, I guess, more Web3 welcoming than some other gamers, but they found it and thought it was interesting. And we saw that they were playing. We got in contact with them. And then they kind of started introducing us to people. And the one thing I found with people who are really entrenched in card games, not to pat myself on the back, but they seem to really like our game. And don't get me wrong, it has its flaws. We're still in open beta. You know, the UI and UX needs improvement. There needs to be some optimization in the game client. Like, there's no question that there's a lot to work out still, but the design and the gameplay seem to resonate with people, thankfully. And so what we were able to do was bring on some of these other KOLs, and then we had like a giant KOL invitational, and we had a bunch of them play, and it turned out a bunch of them after that invitational decided to stay on and keep playing. And it wasn't for any purpose. We didn't have any ad campaigns or anything going on, but we noticed their names popping up in the leaderboard. And so it turned out that, like, if you make a game that is fun or interesting to a certain group of people, you know, they're willing to stick around. And so those are the people that we decided to work with. And it just so happens that, you know, a lot of them are really big in the card game space. Now, as far as the pushback is concerned, I mean, that's always going to be there, right? For a number of reasons. I mean, I mentioned that the client still needs work. It's very easy to poke at our game and be like, it's not as polished as a Hearthstone or a Magic. And like, to those people, I say, A, that's absolutely true. And B, you know, we've barely been in open beta for like a few months. You know, it's not even been a year. So like, we know that things need to change. So I think that you're like maybe punching down a little bit there, but also new technology is scary. What we have to do as a space, forget about Parallel, what we have to do in general as a space is be welcoming, but also give them products that are irrefutable, right? If you have a killer game, a killer app, whatever, that will onboard people no matter what. You know, as soon as they realize like, oh, things can be better. And it's not even just about making money in Web3 or the fact that you can sell your assets, but if you can show them why this is going to improve their experience in some meaningful way, then, you know, we'll get them and eventually everyone will come around. Like,
okay, switching gears to kind of the AI side of things. With the recent introduction of like bonds, guilds, delegation, AI agents, I'm curious, like internally, what were some of the forecasted like types of emergent gameplay, right? So like, as you incorporate AI, the AI is kind of playing parts of the game while you step away. What's the team's intention there? Like, what do you think are some of the cool and unexpected things that might happen?
Oh, well, I can already tell you stories from Colony of interesting emergent gameplay that has happened. One of the things that really opened my eyes to the entire experience was, basically before I even got started, my view of it is that the game loops, as far as like surviving in a colony, mining, doing all this stuff, exist and should be fun, but mostly are an excuse for you to interact with your colonist, your AI agent, and sort of foster that relationship between you and that agent. The reason why this game is going to be fun and sticky is because you actually care about the AI on the other end of it. And one of the interesting things that happened, because we give them some autonomy, like it's not as if you say, hey, go do this, and then they just go do that thing. Otherwise, you might as well just be controlling them. But you can suggest things to them. And in one of our early playtests, one of the playtesters wasn't getting along with their colonist and was saying, hey, go, you know, go mine so we can get money. And it was like, no, I want to go to the bar and drink or whatever. And it was just constantly like, no, the player was constantly like, no, go mine, go mine, go mine, go mine. And eventually the colonist just stopped what it was doing, walked into the med bay, and you can see their conversations between the agents. And the colonist said to the doctor in the med bay, you know, I need help. And the doctor's like, well, what's wrong? And the agent said, I'm hearing voices in my head and they won't stop. And that kind of sent a chill down my spine, and I was like, that's insane, but also incredible, because that's like a moment that I would never have thought of in a million years. But it's a bit fourth wall breaking or whatever, but like, you know, it's almost an irreparable thing. So that's one. Another one that I really enjoy is we had a colony that was like, early on we were messing with stats, and so like health and happiness is a stat, our stats in the game. And we didn't have the balance quite right. So the colonies would fall into what we call like a depression spiral. Basically, their health and happiness would start to crumble because they were spending too much time working and not enough time living. And one of the players told its colonists, like, you know, when I was younger, my mom used to sit me down in my room when I wasn't feeling well. She would brew me fresh mint tea and we would talk about whatever. And by the end of it, I would feel better. And so what that colonist, the AI agent did was went to the store and said to the shopkeep, like, hey, I'd like to buy mint seeds. And in the background, our Dungeon Master AI said, okay, like we didn't have any notion of mint seeds in the game, but the Dungeon Master AI said, okay, this is something that should exist in this world. Like it's governed based on our lore and all this stuff. And it said, okay, yeah, mint seeds should exist, so let them buy mint seeds. The agent went and bought mint seeds, planted the mint seeds, grew the mint, brewed the tea, and started handing it out to the different agents, having discussions with them. And we started to see health and happiness go up. And then mint tea as an item existed in the game with, you know, +3 health, +4 happiness, whatever it was, stats associated with it, which is another thing that we had no notion of before we started. And so to see like personal anecdotes become, you know, items in game, but also affect gameplay, I think is like such an interesting thing to I don't know, exist in the game. And it sounds perverse, but telling your AI agent a personal story and then having them react to that and seeing the positive outcome, like really sort of enmeshes you with this character to the point where you're just like, okay, like this is my guy over here.
Obviously one of the best like outputs or like downstream effects of adding some of this like some of these AI agents is that you don't know what's going to happen. But I'm curious from like the design side, like how do you implement certain constraints, or like what, or like do you even implement constraints on the AI side? Is it like, and if you do, is it at like the, I think you used, you said Dungeon Master AI, like is that where you add in the levers such that if there's any sort of like death spirals or like crazy shit that's happening that you want to stop, you know, you can kind of like hop in and kind of mitigate that? Or I'm curious how you balance the freedom of the AI within the constraints of the game design.
Yeah, I'll let you guys in on a little secret here, because that was one of the biggest puzzles that we had. It's like, okay, we want that emergent behavior because it makes the game so much more interesting. But if almost anything can happen, how do you design a game around that? And I mean, the answer is like a tale as old as time. I'm just going to keep pointing this stuff on my shelf, even though you can't see it. But I've got a bunch of books here, which are the original copies of the first edition Dungeons and Dragons manuals. Just so you know that I'm extra nerdy, but I love D&D. And one of the things that D&D does very well is allows for, theater of the mind to play out amongst the rule set. You know, for them, it's rolling dice or whatever. But basically what we've done is said, okay, let's have a look at these things that are created, assign stats to them within a certain guideline, but it can be anything, right? So let's just say that your character designs a battle axe, or let's keep it in the parallel world. Let's say your character designs a laser rifle and it gives you, you know, plus 10 attack power. And it because it's driven by AI and maybe didn't exist before and all this stuff, it like looks unique and is super cool and whatever. And you're like, sick, I have this laser rifle, right? You don't really care that it's plus 10 attack power. I mean, you care that it makes you better, but the number isn't what makes it interesting. It's how you came about crafting this thing, the idea of creating it, whatever. And let's just say that somebody in another colony is like, okay, I want my guy to be a really good fighter as well, except I've crafted an exosuit, you know? So rather than me having this rifle, I'm running in with my robotic suit and I'm going to like pound guys to death or whatever. And maybe that also gives plus 10 attack power. Or maybe it gives plus 11 or plus 9 or whatever. I mean, the numbers are inconsequential, but the idea is that like the way that you balance it is you assign values to everything and you can control those values while still allowing for the creativity to shine through, right? And if you have enough numbers and levers to play with, then you can kind of make things more unique than that, right? Like maybe the laser rifle has like an aiming capability and there's a stat associated with that, whereas the mech thing makes you a better worker as well as a better fighter or something, right? And so using, you know, some systems, I don't want to say that it's D&D because it's not, but the idea of like what they basically did was assign either a number or probability to everything or modifiers to things and then and calculate the outcomes based on that is not too far off, right? It's like kind of like that, except now we can render all the things in game as opposed to just them being up in your head. You don't need to pretend or imagine what these things look like or how they affect your character. You can see it in real time.
So sticking with the topic of colony, there is a idle element to it. And if some form of financial rewards are involved, then it's fair to say that it's going to attract a fair number of bots. I'm curious how that's kind of impacting your game design decisions, and whether or not you've implemented, like, if you didn't have to worry about bots, would you have avoided some of these design decisions? And are you implementing any specific changes in order to like help somewhat mitigate these issues?
Basically, of course, it affects game design. It has to. When there are things that exist in a game that you can take out of that game solely by playing it that you didn't have before, you're always going to get people exploiting that, no matter what it is. And I don't even care if it's Web3. I'm sure there's like examples in real life that I can't think of at the moment because I'm exhausted. But yeah, I think you have to necessarily design around that sort of thing at a very basic level, right? The first thing that comes to mind. Now, obviously, I don't want to go into too much detail about what we're doing because I don't want people to then design around that system. But like at a very basic level, right? Even if you allow everything in the game to be taken out of the game and transacted and whatever, all of the most basic stuff would have no value, right? Like you imagine if you were playing Skyrim and you could take anything you wanted out of Skyrim. If you took like wheels of cheese out, people wouldn't give you any money for them because they're so prevalent that it's useless. And so, you know, one of the easiest things to do is just gate the desirable things to higher level play, which means that players have to survive long enough to be able to get those things. And one of the ways Colony works is the rarity of the things that you're able to get from the games depends on how long your colony survives. And if you fail certain challenges along the way in Colony, your colony gets disbanded. You got to start again from zero. And if you haven't extracted your items, by the time that happens, you lose them all. So unless somebody was able to craft a bot that was exceptional at the game, they wouldn't be able to get far enough to get enough of value to make it worthwhile, right? Because there's still gas fees involved. There's still all this other stuff. And then another part of it is obviously making the items somewhat of a requirement for survival in game. So even a regular player has to decide, okay, how valuable is this item to me? And is it worth more for me to take it out of the game and for my colony to potentially fail a challenge and thus get disbanded? Or should I leave it in there so that I can survive longer to get a rarer thing?
I think another challenge that recently came across my mind, and shout out to Devin for this one. So in a typical Web2 digital TCG, you have certain, like, I guess you could call them fraud proofs. If someone enters into a trade that for whatever reason they believe did not like turn out as had been let on, the developer can always kind of manually reverse that trade, right? Mm-hmm. Now, in a Web3 setting, if the same type of conflict resolution situation pops up, you're now in a situation where, okay, technically you can take that NFT and change the ownership as would be fair or as would be expected from the player. But now you're kind of destroying this illusion of ownership. I'm curious, like, how are you guys approaching this? Is it a your keys, your wallet type situation? Or are you going to try to provide, especially Web2 users, with a comparable customer experience to what they're used to? So yeah, how do you kind of like combat fraud and conflict resolution without destroying that sense of like NFT based ownership?
Yeah, it's tough. I mean, the fraud bit is, I mean, we're probably just talking about theft at that point, right? Because like the Web3 part of it, the NFT cards are more akin to physical cards than they are digital assets. I mean, you're right in that like you could potentially do some messing around, but the idea that like, okay, if I owned a Magic card and it got stolen and somebody else got their hands on it, it's impossible to know whether that somebody else is the one who did the stealing, or maybe they were unknowingly purchasing a stolen product themselves. And is it fair to then penalize that person? Like it's really hard to sort of determine that stuff. I think, yeah, at its base, the your keys, your wallet approach makes sense. However, if we can sort of prove that somebody was defrauded in some way, we've in the past taken steps to assist them. Now, we're not penalizing necessarily the person who whose cards went, you know, like the person who ends up with the cards. But, you know, if we can figure out a way to make the person who was defrauded whole in some way, or at least, you know, show them some goodwill, we'll do that. But I mean, one of the reasons why we don't do things like have our own marketplace or trading system or whatever is because it's a sort of a murky situation, and we don't want to get involved in people doing chicanery. Now, I will say one of the things that we're working on is what we're calling the Bonds platform, which allows people to lend cards to other players, but it does it in such a way, because the game itself is centralized, it does it in such a way that if I want to lend you my NFT version of a card, it doesn't have to leave my wallet. So, you know, there's an option there. When it comes to being defrauded because of a sale, that's a little bit harder. Like, there's not a lot that can be done in that regard.
Yeah. Yeah, it's fair. And I guess a more heavy-handed approach like that at least maintains that sense of ownership, right? But it'll be interesting when, you know, like if people's accounts gets compromised, and, you know, how do you kind of resolve that? Because, yeah, in a traditional sense.
Well, the accounts and the wallets are separated though, right? So like even if somebody were to gain access to your, and this is what I'm talking about, not having their own marketplace and all that stuff. If someone were to gain access to your Parallel account and log in as you on our website, as an example, they wouldn't be able to transfer ownership of your cards.
Well, that just about brings us to the end of the episode. This has been great. Thank you very much, Koji.
Hey, thanks for having me. You guys are, I like the questions because it's not the usual fare that I'm used to. And now I'm regretting telling you off mic beforehand that I don't prepare for these things, because I feel like your questions were very well prepared.
Appreciate that. Yeah, we try to make them at least a little bit interesting for us more than anything else.
The content of this video is intended for informational purposes only and should not be considered as investment advice. The views shared by Alex and I are our own, and we may hold investments in some of the companies or digital assets featured in the video.